Thank you for coming. Apparently, I need no introduction. So I'm Miguel Soriano. My seminar will be about dynamics and applications of the decoupled semiconductor lasers. The idea is to present to you the results that have been discussed in the review of modern physics paper that I published together with Jordi García Jalbo, Carly Miranda, and Fisher. It was published earlier this year in the review of modern physics. And there, we covered an overview of single and two delay coupled lasers, the extension to network motifs and small networks. And we discussed emerging complex phenomena, deterministic chaos, synchronization, and also the application of these properties. Not only this, but we also give hints of ideas for possible research lines. So it's covering the past and also giving some ideas for the future. So what's so special about delay coupled systems? And these systems are the simple form of an infinite dimensional phase space. It is infinite dimensional because the state of the system depends on the current state and also as a function of the past. This makes the system infinite dimensional, as I said. And it's interesting from the fundamental point of view, and also it's also a simple way to construct in hardware an infinite dimensional system. And in practice, has many dimensions. So what is also, I will be talking about semiconductor lasers. These semiconductor lasers are the backbone of telecom and datacom systems today. Today, they represent 50% of laser market volume. This is in dollars, let's say. But if you talk about number of devices, this is about 90% of the lasers that are produced today as of the type of semiconductor lasers.
In euros, they are about the
50%? 50% also in dollars, in euros. Yeah. So in money, let's say. Monetary value is 50%. And they are extremely versatile. And since they are so popular, they come in different flavors. You find different geometries, also different engineering of the game, quantum dot, quantum worlds. Different materials for different wavelengths. Here I highlight, for instance, just different geometries. On the one hand, here on the left, an edge-emitting laser. This is a laser that has been drawn on top of a substrate. And here the light is emitted parallel to the substrate, so in the same direction of the substrate. In contrast, here, a vertical cavity surface-emitting laser, also drawn on top of a substrate, but in this case, the light is emitted perpendicular to the substrate. These two types are one of the most popular devices. What all semiconductor lasers have in common is that they are extremely sensitive to external perturbations. And this is what I will discuss today. And this was already noticed a while ago, so it's not only now that we are studying, it was already observed in the 70s. And the first observations, they observed some pulsations of the laser when subject to feedback, also changing the frequency on the optical frequency on the lasers. And in 1980 was a similar paper by Lang and Kobayashi where they give also a model to this kind of dynamics. And this is a field that has interested engineers, physicists, also mathematicians because of the interesting properties of this system. And even if it's studied since the 80s, we have now the tools to study it with more detail. For instance, what we can see, if you have a laser, you couple the light out of the laser to a mirror and back into the laser. The first thing you observe is that instead of having a simple emission or just a simple device without feedback, which has here in red these nice properties, which is a narrow land width and the relaxation oscillation side bands. Once you have optical feedback in black in this picture, you see that the optical power versus frequency, you see that the frequency of this laser subject to feedback increases from the order of megahertz typically to the order of gigahertz. So it's three orders of magnitude increase in frequency. That means that the output of the laser, instead of being constant, becomes chaotic, pulsating. This optical feedback is often said that it comes from undesired back reflections. It can come from the tip of a fiber, also from some optical components, even from the surface of a CD, but it's not always undesired. And particularly not for us, because once you understand the properties of races with feedback, you can use it for applications. So in this seminar, I will cover these three things. I will start with fundamental properties of races with feedback. I will show you some practical applications, and I will move to give you some future perspectives. The simplest way to describe a semiconductor laser is by using a rate equation model. This rate equation model has some approximations. In particular, it describes a single longitudinal and transfer mode emission. It has two equations. Here, one for the electric field in the laser cavity, and another equation for the carriers, for the excess carriers in the laser cavity. In the field equation, we have the alpha factor, or Landwirth enhancement factor, which is typical of semiconductor lasers. This is one of the main linearities of semiconductor lasers that relates amplitude and phase. And in the carrier equation, here P is the excess current over threshold, ITH is the solitary lasing threshold current, gamma E is the carrier decay rate, okay, and capital gamma naught is the photon decay rate. With these three equations, you can describe a solitary laser. And typically, this has the solution of these equations are just the continuous wave emission. And the only dynamical feature that you can observe is the relaxation oscillation. And that is that when you change one continuous wave operation to another, the laser responds with a series of pulses with a given frequency, which is the relaxation oscillation, and a given damping, which is the damping of the relaxation.
Yeah, or you have to say what is P.
P?
Capital.
Yeah, capital P here, it is the model is normalized such that the amplitude of the field, the modulus square of the field, sorry, that's the number of photons. So that's the P. So P here is related to the modulus square of the field. This model can be extended to account for optical feedback. And in the most simple approximation, you can account for only a single reflection in the external cavity, so you have a laser with feedback. And in the previous rate equations, you add a term which accounts for this feedback. This is the intensity of the feedback, the feedback intensity, the delay in the optical cavity, in the external cavity, and this is the phase of the feedback. So these are the main parameters that describe the external optical feedback. This model is called Lang-Kobayashi because they were the first to introduce this kind of approach in the seminal paper. And it is very simple. It has you could think of a model that has that takes into account more reflections or maybe some other approximations. But this is a very simple model. And the nice thing about it is that it captures the basic features of the experimental findings, like the feedback-induced instabilities that we want to study. And this is also a simple model for mathematicians to study. One of the easiest ways to understand these equations is by looking at the fixed points of these equations. And the fixed points of these equations, of the solutions of the Lang-Kobayashi equations, are also called external cavity modes. And the external cavity modes are solutions of the rotating wave. These solutions have a fixed intensity, a fixed frequency, and also a fixed number of carriers. And if a given projection is chosen, an appropriate one, for instance here, carriers versus frequency, these external cavity modes, which are the solutions of the Lang-Kobayashi equations, they lie on an ellipse. An ellipse here, like depicted here in this picture. And other external cavity modes are here. This line separates the unstable with the modes that can be stable. So the modes that are above the line are always unstable, and the modes that are below the line can be sometimes stable. And this ellipse relates to the parameters of the feedback. For instance, the extent of the ellipse is proportional to the feedback strength and to the line width enhancement factor of the equations. And the number of modes that you have inside the ellipse is proportional to the feedback strength, the Landwirth enhancement factor, and also to the delay time.
What is the
the extent of the ellipses, I mean the large semi-axis.
So the frequency extent, this is given by the feedback extent, so larger feedback, also you have a larger ellipse, and also larger Leibniz-Hausman factor, you have a larger or more extended ellipse in frequency. What else? And concerning the number of modes, they change with the delay time. A longer delay time means that you have more externality modes. The delay time doesn't change the extent of the ellipse, but it changes how much this is filled. Right. So this kind of picture, like a projection to an ellipse, is very useful to understand the properties of lasers at the optical feedback. For instance, it has been used to explain the regime of low frequency fluctuations. I assume some of you are familiar with this regime. For the ones that are not, this is the intensity of the laser subject to feedback versus time, and in this intensity, this is numerical simulations. What you can find for these low frequency fluctuation regimes is that the power increases with a rising trend until it drops suddenly, and this process continues all over again, and this is repeated many times. You can observe this in the intensity of the laser, also in the phase difference of the laser, and in the carriers also of the laser. This kind of dynamics you can understand better if you use the projection of the ellipse. So if you take, for instance, the carriers, and you project it versus the phase difference, which is equivalent to have it here in the frequency, you see that when you project the dynamics on this in this projection, the build-up of the power means this, it's equivalent to oscillations around the external cavity modes towards the gain with higher towards the mode with highest gain, and then here there is a collision with an unstable mode, and then the emission is rejected back to the solitary mode, and that is equivalent to the dropouts. So every time you have this trend of increasing power, and then the collision to the unstable mode, and this starts all over again. And for that, this kind of representation is very useful, because otherwise you wouldn't be able to understand it properly. One note is that even if this comes from numerical simulations, all the quantities have been smooth. So these are average quantities. This is done because for many years, the experiments were always average, because the detection of the experimental bandwidth was always limited, and this was the only thing that was observed experimentally, the average quantity, but this is not the real truth. So what is happening in the laser is that there is some fast pulsing below these low frequency fluctuations, and for this I show you a picture with the limited bandwidth and the fully resolved one experimentally. With an average intensity, you only see this average level and then the dropouts, typical of the low frequency fluctuations, but actually you have the full bandwidth. And the full bandwidth means moving from a bandwidth of around 500 MHz to something like more than 10 GHz. That's what you need to recognize the full bandwidth of the dynamics. So if you have these dynamics, then you can recognize these picosecond pulsations or sub-nanosecond pulsations that the laser has when subject to feedback. This was first observed in 1996, but it was observed by using a strict camera, not by using an oscilloscope. So now I show you what we can do here in IFIS. In IFIS we study lasers with feedback. We mainly use with fiber-based setups. So here a laser, which is fiber pigtail. The light goes to the fiber, and we build a fiber loop, which gives us the feedback, and also part of the light is used for detection. I give you an artistic view of some of these fiber components. Here an attenuator, polarization controller, some fiber connections. And with these fiber setups are very versatile, and we can really tune all the parameters of the feedback very easily. And regarding detection, we have an oscilloscope with an analog bandwidth of 16 GHz. This kind of scopes is the first generation that allows, together with a fast photodiode, to detect the full bandwidth of the dynamics of the laser with feedback. Here I give you an example of the time series of the laser with feedback, where you see, where you, here in nanosecond, you see the sub-nanosecond pulsations of the laser that are resolved for continuous time. We cannot, not only we can measure the intensity of the laser, but we can also measure in real time the optical frequency. So this is something that has been done only now, and it was impossible to do before. And we benefit from the experimental capabilities of our lab. And in this case, we measure the optical frequency via this via heterodyne technique, and we measure the optical spectra with high resolution and also in real time. That means that we can measure at the same time the intensity and the optical frequency dynamics, and with that we can recover the ellipse. We could recover the ellipse picture that I showed you before, typical of the Lanco-Boyer equation. So we can understand now, or we can see in practice, if the Lanco-Boyer describes fully the system or not. So that, and this has been done for the first time. We can even resolve the external cavity modes. Here we have about 1,000 external cavity modes because we use very long delays. Our setups typically, since they have fiber, they are typically of several meters, and that means that the delay is about 70 nanoseconds, so very large, and that means that you have 1,000 external cavity modes. And still, we can resolve the modes. So I showed you now the properties of the single laser with feedback. I would like to show you now the, some properties of networks of the decoupled lasers. And this connects to a full, we want to understand emerging complex phenomena, and this fits in a wider picture. So it connects the knowledge from complex networks, also it has implications for neuroscience, and here I will look at it from the perspective of the laser systems, but the conclusion extracted from the laser systems can also be applied to the other two, and there is a positive cross-fertilization among these different subjects. The first example of coupling using lasers was a very simple one. It was just using unidirectional coupling. So here, a laser with feedback was coupled unidirectionally to a second laser, which sometimes had also optical feedback, not in this case. And for the first time, it was done with numerical simulations of Lanco-Boyer equations, and it was predicted that chaos synchronization was possible. So given a laser, a chaotic laser, here SL1, which is, has chaotic oscillations, this was coupled to a set of equations describing a second laser, and after a transient, it was seen that the second laser synchronized to the previous one, and the synchronization error here goes to zero. This was the first example of chaos synchronization in numerics, and also it was with this equation they also computed the Lyapunov exponents of the laser with feedback, and it was found, as expected, that it was a large number of positive Lyapunov exponents.
Yeah, how do you calculate the synchronization error? Do you need to use seem to see a large
SL1
and SL2, so you're calculating.
So you compensate for this. For this time. So the coupling time in the end gives you that the second laser is has this shift in itself, so for the synchronization error you correct for this coupling time. That doesn't affect the dynamics, it's only just a matter of response time. So as I was saying, this is an example of hyper chaos. So it was found indeed that this delay in this dynamics has a large number of positive Lyapunov exponents. After the numerical predictions, it was also checked experimentally that the two coupled lasers, or two unidirectional coupled lasers, can synchronize in practice.
Well, I have to note that the first numerical simulation of two synchronized semiconductor lasers was done 2 years before all the reactors.
Yeah, I'm wrong. It was just here. The interesting thing is that it's about.
You can calculate years. Many things, but to show synchronization, you don't need to calculate all those things.
Yeah, you're right. Using chaos-based optical communication, it was also shown earlier that you could use chaos synchronization in lasers for chaos-based communication, but then regarding the Lyapunov exponents, this was the first time it was done. So sorry for the imposition. And also, this was shown experimentally. Here I give you an impression of the experimental results. And experimentally, it's also interesting to note that it was found that the sensitivity, there was a strong sensitivity of the synchronization quality to parameter mismatch between the lasers. So if one, here, this is the correlation function which measures the degree of synchronization, and one plots that as a function of the detuning frequency, which is the difference in emission wavelength between laser 1 and 2, just a small detuning in frequency between the lasers makes this creates this strong decay in the synchronization, and it was an example of this strong sensitivity of synchronization in lasers, which is something very common. Moving forward from just this simple example of unidirectional coupling, I also want to discuss about a chain of three bidirectional coupled lasers. In this case, it was very interesting that it was very interesting to find identical synchronization between lasers that are at a distant position. So there is here considered there are coupling delays in between. Still, lasers 1 and 3 were found to be synchronized at zero lag. At zero lag means that the intensity of the lasers are synchronized with zero delay. So here there is no compensation for delay times. They are really happening at the same time. And if you compute a cross correlation between this laser 1 and 3, they have a high correlation at zero, proving this zero lag synchronization. And this happens thanks to the existence of this relay, which in this case is another laser, so it's an active relay. This kind of phenomena of zero lag synchronization is also observed in the case of a passive relay, so you could use a mirror in between and this phenomena would still hold. And this has also implications for neuroscience. I will comment on that later. But to me, it is fascinating that you can find identical synchronization at zero lag, even if the lasers are spaced in time and in distance. I gave you an example of a chain of three coupled lasers. There have also been some experimental examples of a bidirectional ring of three lasers. So in this case, this is the setup with bidirectional coupling between the lasers. And they found in this case that all lasers were identically synchronized. So this is the autocorrelation function of the three lasers, and all these three lasers are synchronized identically. Another example, going from 3 to 4 bidirectional coupled lasers, like in they are now in a ring and the couplings are bidirectional. In this case, you don't find identical synchronization of all lasers, but you find what is called sublattice synchronization, such that opposite lasers, so here A and B are identically synchronized among them, C and D are identically synchronized among them, so this kind of sublattice synchronization. But in order to, so this can only happen if all neighbors are in a state of generalized synchronization. So here I would like to make a small break and discuss what is this generalized synchronization and what is identical synchronization, because this is something that is often found in lasers. For identical synchronization, I mean just that one follows the other identically, such that if you plot one as a function of the other, they follow a line. That means that as the time goes to infinity, the difference between the two systems or lasers in this case goes to zero. This is a very simple case to characterize, and just a linear correlation can work to detect identical synchronization. In contrast, you can also find in coupled lasers, you can find the state of generalized synchronization. And in this case, it's not a line, but there's some function. One is some function of the other. And the definitions of generalized synchronization says that there is a given function, can be nonlinear, where in this projection of a transformation of one minus the other, this when time goes to infinity, the difference between these two go to zero. Since there is some nonlinear transformation of one, sometimes the linear correlation does not work.
So, in simple cases, it would work, but I will show you that in some extreme cases, correlation fails.
And the simple example is, for instance, when you couple two lasers face to face with a given delay. This is the simple example of generalized synchronization. So in this case, it's not identical, but generalized. You can see that it's generalized because the correlation, this is the maximum of the correlation as a function of the coupling strength, doesn't reach 1, but is below 1, it's about 0.8 in experiments. And in this case, if you look at the cross correlation between lasers 1 and 2, as a function of the time, they don't correlate at 0, but actually at plus minus the delay. And this fact that the correlation doesn't reach 1 is just a consequence of generalized synchronization. You can take the concept of generalized synchronization to the limit, and that is by building a ring of unidirectionally coupled lasers. Here you have n unidirectionally coupled lasers, and for some range of parameters, which we showed in the past that it was that these all lasers were in a generalized synchronization state. But when we increased the number of elements in the number of lasers in the ring, and we wanted to compute, and we wanted to characterize the synchronization state, and we computed the cross correlation between element 0 here, for instance, and n over 2, which are the elements that are more distant in the ring, we computed the cross correlation. And the more elements you had in the ring, this correlation decayed. So we knew that they were in a generalized synchronized, but we couldn't measure it. So the only way to test for generalized synchronization that we could find that it works is by using the auxiliary system approach. The auxiliary system works as follows: you couple the output of the ring to a linear chain of lasers equal to the ones that are here in the ring, and then what you can do now is you can compute the cross correlation between an element in the ring and an element in the chain, and if these two elements are in a state of identical synchronization, it means that then lasers 0 and n over 2 have to be in a state of generalized chaos synchronization. So just to keep in mind that even if it's difficult to measure, chaos synchronization is not limited to identical synchronization, but you can have these extreme cases of generalized synchronization. So how do we know if two coupled lasers are going to synchronize or not? So this relates to the work of the group of Professor Kinzel, also Thomas here. It was published 2 years ago, and they studied strong and weak chaos in networks of with time delay couplings, also with examples of semiconductor lasers. And they distinguish two kinds of chaotic dynamics, strong chaos and weak chaos. And the difference is you can see if it's in one state or the other by measuring at the largest Lyapunov exponent of the system. So if you are able to measure the largest Lyapunov exponent and you find that this exponent is independent of the delay time, then the lasers are in strong chaos and it's impossible that they synchronize. Following this argument, if the largest Lyapunov exponent is of the order of the inverse of the delay time, so that that means that it changes with the delay time, then the chaos is set the laser is said to be in a state of weak chaos, and this is the only possibility where the lasers can synchronize, and of course it can be either identical or generalized chaos synchronization depending on the topology of the coupling. As an example, they can compute it. These Lyapunov exponents for the numerical simulations of the Rankine-Bayes equation. I remind you, the Rankine-Bayes equations are the equations that describe a single laser with feedback. And here, what I plot is the largest Lyapunov exponent of the system as a function of the feedback strength. And they found that there is a region of weak chaos for very weak feedbacks, a region of strong chaos for intermediate feedback strengths, and a region of weak chaos for larger feedback strengths. So I don't want to confuse you, because I said this can only be computed when you change the delay. So that means that for these feedback strengths, if you change the delay of the system once it is in the long cavity regime, so several nanoseconds, if you change the delay, the exponent doesn't change in this region. In contrast, if you are in the weak chaos, and for this feedback strength you change the delay type, then the, for instance, if you increase it, if you increase the delay, then the value of the Lyapunov exponent will decrease because they are in this inversely proportional in this region. Interestingly, for lasers, this strong chaos can also be identified with the autocorrelation function. So we found that there was a correspondence between the values of the Lyapunov exponent and here the peak of the autocorrelation at the delay time. So you compute the autocorrelation of the laser, you look at the peak, autocorrelation peak at the delay time, you check the height of this peak, and that's what you plot here, what is it plotted here as a function of the feedback strength. And you can see there is a correspondence within a low value of correlation and the region of strong chaos. So experimentally, we use the cross-correlation function as an indirect way to detect if our lasers will have or not this region of strong or weak chaos. That's what we did in the lab. And we found, with this in mind, looking at the correlation function, we here you see two plots. In the left is the results for the laser with feedback, and it was the first time that we observed experimentally this region of strong chaos. For that, we plot the peak of the autocorrelation function at the delay time as a function of the feedback attenuation, which is the parameter accessible in the experiment. And we see that there is a low value correlation here, meaning that it's strong chaos, and a large value for larger feedbacks, so low attenuations, meaning this is weak chaos. Once you find that the laser with feedback is in external weak chaos, you can check if what happens when you couple two lasers. So that's what we did, and this is the result here, the experimental result here on the right for two coupled lasers. And it's predicted that for strong chaos there's no synchronization, and for weak chaos you can find synchronization. So here we plot the maximum of the cross-correlation function between the two lasers as a function of the coupling, and we recover a region of strong chaos where the lasers are not synchronized, and a region of weak chaos where the lasers can synchronize and reach a high value of the cross-correlation. So this is a way, by using the single laser with feedback, you can predict if the lasers will synchronize when embedded in a coupled configuration. So if you want to know if a network of lasers with delay coupling will synchronize, you can just look at the properties of the single one. And this just this is a collaboration with Thomas here in the audience and the group of Wolfgang Kinsler, and we have this just accepted in this category. With this, I finished the first and longest part of the presentation, and now I will cover. I will give you some ideas about practical applications of delay coupled lasers and some future perspectives. For the applications of delay coupled lasers, they have been used in several ways. For instance, in chaos-based optical communications, also for ranging and sensing, they have been used for the generation of random numbers. I will also comment on reservoir computing, for instance, and then I will also cover similarities with neuronal systems. Concerning ranging and sensing, the idea here is to use a laser with feedback as a chaotic source, in such that they, in what is known a chaotic LiDAR. This is used to measure distances, or to measure the distance of an object which is far away. And due to the fast temporal decorrelation of a chaotic laser, you can improve the resolution. And here's an example where you can detect an object which is moved 50 centimeters from the starting position using a chaotic LiDAR. Also, you can reduce the noise in the channel using the synchronization properties of lasers with feedback. Another application for sensing is that you can tune the coherence length of a laser with feedback. Here I give you an example. If this is the coherence length of a laser as a function of the feedback strength, experimentally. And the coherence length of a laser can change from several meters, here not shown, to below even a centimeter just by changing the feedback strength. So in the case where you want to avoid coherence, because this gives you interference effects when you want to measure in detail an object, you can decrease the coherence of the laser line and avoid these interference effects. And for that, lasers with feedback have been also used. Semiconductor lasers with feedback are also used as a source of randomness. We've seen some seminars about that here by NEMS, for instance. Semiconductor lasers have a large frequency bandwidth. And here what we use is that lasers have some intrinsic noise, the spontaneous emission of the laser, that gives you the possibility to generate randomness, and as such, the performance of lasers with feedback is comparable to that of super emission diodes, which only use amplified as spontaneous emission. The two systems are comparable. In any case, all these approaches require some digital post-processing. So you need to detect the analog signal of the laser converted to digital, and with the digital signal you can do bit truncation, some logical operation with it, and as such produce random bits. The first implementation of that was by Uchida and co-workers, published in Nature Photonics in 2008. Here I give you an idea of the setup. They used two lasers with feedback. They combined the output of these two lasers with feedback with an XOR, and they produced random bits. This was an online random bit generation at 1.7 gigabits per second, and this was at the time the fastest physical random bit generator, so it was very important. Now the technology has evolved. For instance, now I can tell you that with experiments of NEUS we are working with a laser with feedback that produces 160 gigabits per second random bits. And as I said, the working principle for this is that the chaos induced decoration of the trajectories together with the inherent noise of the laser creates these different trajectories. For instance, here this is a simulation of the intensity of the laser as a function of time, having no with or without noise, and you see that with noise the trajectory diverges one to each other, so that means that the trajectories are never repeated and are useful to generate random bits. Lasers with feedback have also been used in chaos-based optical communications. In this case, the laser with feedback is driven in the chaotic regime that is used as a chaotic carrier, which is the meter. And you can hide a small message inside the chaotic carrier and send it to another laser with or without feedback. And the nice thing here is that the second laser only synchronizes to the chaotic carrier, and it sees the message as a perturbation, and as such, you can, by comparing the output of the receiver laser to the incoming signal, you can recover the message that was hidden into the chaotic carrier. This was shown in a Nature paper in 2005 in the metropolitan area of Athens. So this concept is compatible with the standard standard telecom component. Here we have an example of the input message, and you cannot see this message when it is hidden in the transmitted signal because it has a smaller amplitude, and you only see the chaotic fluctuations of the laser. But you can recover by chaos synchronization. You can recover the message that was encoded in the signal. You can do that with low errors at a high bit rate, for instance, at around 1-2 gigabits per second. And this is, I want you to keep in mind, this is security at the hardware level, so this can be complementary to other software level software cryptography. Another thing on this kind of protocols for security, this is slightly different. This is for the distribution of a key. The problem here is to create a key in a secure manner between Alice and Bob. They do that over a public channel, and you don't want an external observer to see that to have information about this key that is being generated. So you need to do it such that the outsider cannot see it. I will show you a protocol that works on synchronization, and the synchronization state will define the key. Since the synchronization is very sensitive to the parameters of the lasers, we will modulate lasers for that. So in our IFISC implementation, we have Xavi that wants to send a message to Constantine, and they both have a laser to modulate, and they modulate with random modulations. Random modulations different in laser 1 and 2, and we have found that only when the modulating bit is the same in the two sides is the only case where the two lasers synchronize. So this, when the two bits are the same, you find a synchronized state. It can be either 0-0 or 1-1, and these bits you keep for the key. In contrast, if you find that the two partners, Xavi and Constantine, have a different bit in the modulation, then the lasers do not synchronize, and then these bits are discarded. The nice thing of this protocol is that the outsider observer can only see synchronization or not synchronization state, but in the synchronized state, they don't know if they sent a 0 or a 1 because it's hidden in the chaotic carrier. So this is a way to generate a key over a public channel. As I told you, the chain of three lasers and this concept of dynamical relaying has also some implications for neuroscience. For instance, here I show you how this concept was translated for lasers to neuronal populations. Here, 1, 2, and 3 are three different neuronal populations coupled with different delays. And it was found that even if the neural populations are separated with a given time, just by the mediation of the relay, populations 1 and 3 emit pulses at the same time, at zero time. So again, it's a proof of zero lag synchronization. And this indicates that this kind of dynamical relaying, so using a relay can be active or passive, could be a possible mechanism of information integration in the brain, where information comes from different areas and from different delays. Still, it has to be integrated at the same time and processed at the same time. So this could be a process, this could be the mechanism for information integration. For the last practical application, I want to just give you a couple of slides of reservoir computing. In reservoir computing, some of you, I don't know if you are familiar with it, but I explain it just in a small detail. Reservoir computing is a way of unconventional computing. It uses computation with recurrent neural networks. So here, this recurrent neural network is what is called the reservoir. To that, you have an input, and by looking at the response of the network, and by training, you can use it for several tasks. The properties of these recurrent neural networks that they have fading memory. Feature expansion, it means that the number of nodes in this network has to be large, such that the information of the input is projected into several states inside the network, so it's high-dimensional projection. And the idea here is that we can build a system based on delay that works equally as the recurrent network. So what we do is we have a nonlinear node, can be an electronic circuit, optoelectronic oscillator, also a laser, and we have a delay. And by using time multiplexing, we can replace the nodes on the network as temporal positions in the delay, and also the fading memory we create by having precisely this delay. So we can replace the full network with a node with time multiplexing, with delay. And the nice thing about this is that it allows a hardware implementation, and that's what we have used for the laser with feedback. As an example, we have used this concept to build an optical reservoir computer. In this case, a laser. Here, this is the laser having a feedback loop, and to that we inject information. Information can come optically from a different laser, or can be added electrically. And for this concept, we benefit from the intrinsic parallelism of optics on the one hand, and also our reservoir computing itself. By using laser, we also exploit the high bandwidth of semiconductor lasers. So this means that we can perform computations at a high speed. Also, the consumption of the laser is very low, so we have low power consumption. And as an example of this parallelism, I show you here in these two pictures the results when we try to recognize spoken digits. So here the task is to recognize a set of spoken digits. It's a database that comes standard for machine learning. And this from these digits you can recognize either the digit, the number itself, or the speaker of that digit. And we do that in parallel. So we have the spoken digits injected into the laser, and by measuring the response of the laser with an oscilloscope, we can use that response of the laser to see the digit and the speaker at the same time with the same output, and we find that it works best around the threshold of the laser, which is here the dashed line. If you want to know more details, we just published this in Nature Communications. And with this, I would like to move to the last part of the presentation, which is about the future perspectives. And for starters, one of the ideas in the short term is to build network motifs of the Delicato lasers. Here in the slide, you see all different modules for three nodes, and only the ones that are marked with an asterisk are a motif. A motif are those modules that occur more frequently than random in real life networks. For instance, a motif is the unidirectional chain. A motif is also the unidirectional ring, or the bidirectional ring, for instance. And given the versatility of the setup that we have with all the fiber-based setups, we can check the influence of a coupling strength in these motifs. We can, to some extent, also change the delay in these motifs. We can change the directionality. We can make the links unidirectional or bidirectional. And in these cases, we can see when synchronization is possible, and when possible, if we find generalized or identical synchronization. Regarding networks, it's also interesting in the context of reservoir computing to see how information is spreading in a network for different dynamical regimes. So that's also something that is interesting for me. Second idea that we are going to test now is to check the consistency of lasers of delay coupled lasers. So what is that? You drive, this is the delay coupled laser. So this, we want to check what is the response of this system when the same drive is applied several times to the system. So we have an input signal, we repeat it several times, and we record the responses of the system to this same input but at different times, and we check if the outputs are similar or not. The check is about how consistent the responses to the same drive are. This is relevant for information processing because in reservoir computing, or in general in nonlinear transient computing, consistency is required. Because we want, in all these concepts, the system is trained to a given input, and with that given input, the system has to learn about the response. If the system is not consistent, then the training fails and you cannot use it for information processing. So we need to work in a regime of consistency for this kind of applications. And also, I think it's interesting to see what is the relationship between the consistency of the decoupled lasers and, if any, the relationship to weak and strong chaos. Also, from a fundamental point of view, it's interesting that now that we have these high-quality experimental time traces that we can record in the lab, we can use them to model evaluation and also parameter estimation of these models. Given that we are testing here devices, lasers with different geometries, with different mechanisms for gain and losses, we can check what is the best model for each of these devices. And for that, I'm starting a collaboration with Professor Parlich in Göttingen. They have a method to check which model suits best from an experimental time trace. And not only that, but you can also obtain the parameters, of course, of the model. And this could be a way to improve the characterization of lasers. So directly from the time series, you can maybe extract all the parameters of the laser, and you don't need to do, instead of using several techniques to recover all the different parameters of the laser and combine those, you can just have the time series out of the laser, and with this kind of procedure recover the parameters of the lasers. I think this is very interesting for the future. And also, as a perspective for the long term, I think I see opportunities for photonic integrated devices So for instance, it has been shown here on top that a single chip can generate different dynamical regimes. In this case, the chip implements feedback from a short cavity, and the phase of the feedback can be tuned, and just by changing the phase of the feedback, you can have either chaotic dynamics or some kind of limit cycles, and the other different regimes, continuous wave, for instance. So this can be used for applications to have everything integrated in a chip. Also, I see possibilities to work with ring lasers, because these are integrated devices, like here in the picture. You can build them such that you can have maybe larger networks of coupled lasers. So it's always difficult to couple more than 3-4 lasers, and maybe this is a way to move to larger networks. And for that, I think we can benefit from the availability of integrated photonics technology that is now, I see it as a trend in commercially. For instance, now Intel is aiming at replacing copper cables, but optical interconnects. And for optical interconnects, they use integrated structures like these ones here, similar to these ones. And this will be used in future data center rack technologies. And they have even a project now with Facebook where they use data centers already with optical interconnects. So in the same way that we benefited from the developments in the telecom market to use telecom devices in a conventional way, I think we can use the improvements on this kind of technology to use them then in a conventional way, like we did with the telecom devices. And with this, I would like to conclude. I showed you that semiconductor lasers are optical feedback are extremely versatile systems. Also, the delay-coupled semiconductor laser are ideal testbeds to check the properties of delay-induced coupling, which is of general interest for several disciplines. One of the key successes of this field I see as the close feedback between the modeling efforts and also the efforts from the experimental side. And I think if this continues in this way, there's also room for more improvement. And importantly, that by studying the single system with delay, the properties of this single system extends to the decoupled elements. So here, this is also important to keep in mind. And for practical applications, I covered some examples, for instance, the chaos-based optical communications, the generation of random bits. Also, I showed that the coherence can be tailored. And as a separate here as a more important point for us, because reservoir computing is an expanding field with has a strong potential, and the goal is to build a kind of photonic brain. That means that you can process information already at the optical level, and you can turn it to transform to electronics. There are also opportunities for photonic integrated sources, like the chaos on a chip that I showed you earlier. And I would like to leave you with a few selective references of the state of the art of this research field here in IFISC. I'm working with Daniel on reservoir computing, with NEOS. We are studying the generation of random bits. I'm working with Xavi and Constantine on the exchange of a secure key. And concerning the fundamental properties, I'm working with Thomas on the concept of strong and weak chaos. And we are also working, as you see here, on the stability of the synchronized solution in coupled lasers, of two delay coupled lasers. And also very interesting is that we can now resolve the optical frequency of the laser with feedback in real time. And I thank you for that.
So the idea with physical random generators is that let me go back to the slide. With the generators that work based on software, you have what is called the pseudo random generators, and for those the problem is that you have recurrences after a given time. So the idea is that using a physical process, these repetitions will not occur.
And
will not occur, and the only one that you can use to test something I didn't comment here, there is a standard of testing randomness that is given by the NIST, the National Institute of Technologies, and what you can, what you have to do stand in the standard is you generate these random bits, you generate 1,000 million bits, and those you enter into the battery of tests, and you obtain a probabilistic value of the randomness of the signal. And that's what we have been doing, and that's what other people working in the field do. And that this sequence is 160 gigabit per second past this random test. And one of the ideas of this kind of approach is that if you can integrate it, you can integrate it in hardware, and then the output, which is already digital, you can plug to a computer or to a different system and use the bits that are produced for online gaming or this kind of applications where real randomness is needed.
When you say that it passes the test, that doesn't mean that it is better.
No, the better is about that the speed is fastest. This is the fastest speed for physical random bit generators.
For software,
there is one problem here because in some simulations, you want to send a set of randomness, which actually you can repeat, so you can check the validity of your simulations. This would not be the case of this kind of randomness because you can never recover the same random bits out of the physical generator. So that maybe is not useful for some kind of simulations, but in the applications where they aim for randomness, I think this is more suitable than the necessarily random ones, because given the seed, you can obviously produce the sequence, which is not the case here.
And the speed, yes, also, do you remember the numbers for computer-based?
Well, in the end, the speed is given by the clock of the processor for software. Mm-hmm. And this includes
20
gigabytes. So this will be comparable.
Yeah, I mean, a typical processor working at 3 GHz will do about net 4 operations in 64 bits, so it could generate easily, you could write up to 8, but for a single code it could be 4 by 64 by 3 GHz, so it's
1200
gigabits per second. Of course, you can use multiple cores and all that. The point is the physical. I mean, if this is a physical system that generates that. So it is a physical system. This is a physical system.
Driven by a software.
Right. It is a physical system that you do all you can to avoid any physical randomness. Because you don't want that. Every time you multiply 32 by 45, it is always the same answer. If you put some randomness in the noise, you take a bad sheet, one of these that makes echoes, that will be better. but the point is that this is not something which is driven by an algorithm, so it's not predictable as an algorithm. Other than that, the speed probably is still faster than a computer if you want to use in a computer.
Let's say the computer is a discrete system, with very many states of the discrete system. This is a continuous system.
Mm-hmm. Well, it has been discretized.
No, because you attempt, you make it discrete. Mm-hmm. So it's not just the fact that it's continuous, the fact is that you assume that there is no way to fully predict all the bits that you are going to generate. Mm-hmm. While in a computer you have an algorithm. Mm-hmm. So the compressibility of the bits that you generate in a computer, if you are clever enough, a sequence of random bits should be compressed to a very short size. Because the algorithm, the size of the algorithm is very small. But the fact is that if you take that sequence and give to any compression mechanism, you don't get that. So it's very difficult to
get. But I mean, with this, that's a stating that you cannot model this in any mathematical way, and this is a very strong statement.
Or the stating that the number of variables that you need to model, all that is very good.
No, because you have the numbers.
But the noise could be modeled with assuming the position of all the quarks that you have.
Yeah, qualitatively.
Quantum thermodynamics over there and all that, and then you can model.
Qualitatively, you can.
But the number of degrees of freedom that is there is huge. That's the
difference. we cannot use that. I mean, this thing of which is physical or not is no, the same sort of reasoning of, well, we cannot model social systems because those are not physical.
But that's not, the point is, the point is not what you can model.
I think it's the algorithm behind it. The pseudo random number generator is really has an algorithm, so you know, if you know the algorithm, you know the sequence. You know the sequence of bits that is going to be produced. In this case, you don't know the state of the system, of the noise of the system at different times, so for that, then the sequence becomes unpredictable and not reproducible.
But if one is able to model that thing in any mathematical way,
one
equation, either deterministic or stochastic, which in a statistical sense.
In a statistical sense,
but the point is, in the mathematical evolution,
I mean, you have your equation, lambda, you have your equation, you put your state, you put your initial conditions. But you know exactly what realization.
Yeah, but that will not give you, I mean, you will not have the power to predict the exact result of a given time that you do the experiment. While for the numerical algorithm that you have in the computer implemented, if the program is not wrong, which sometimes is wrong, if the computer is not wrong, which sometimes is wrong, and if the compiler is not wrong, which sometimes is wrong, then you know exactly what it will give.
Any other question or comment? No?
I have a question.
Okay.
This topic of random number generation, somehow what we are doing here is to extract from the randomness of the time trace and the dynamical evolution of the laser this random part. Do you think that could be possible somehow to remove the random part from the time frame?
Well, the problem here is that the random part already makes the trajectory to diverge, right? So in this case, the different realizations will give you different different trajectories. What we see, at least what we do, I told you about the mechanism. One of them to create the random bits is this bit truncation. In the bit truncation, once you have a digital number with 8 bits, what we do is we keep the 4 least significant bits, which are supposed to contain the most random bits. So from this point of view, we don't when doing this bit truncation, if you want to see it in this kind of experimental plot, what you are giving more emphasis by keeping the least significant bits to the small fluctuations, not to the large amplitudes. So in the large amplitudes, you have that the influence of the large amplitudes in the most significant bits. So you give a more emphasis on the small perturbations of the evolution.
Okay. Anything else? Well, if not, thanks again.
Of the